Parashat Balak is one of the rare parashiyot, in a sense, that is no mitzvot at all. However, Parashat Balak is one of the most important parasha in the Torah because it's dealing with midot, with human trait. I would like to zoom in today in a very practical subject, which is the evil eye, Ein Hara. People ask that question constantly in different avenue, different time, and I would like to share with you a lot of sources in that subject. I collected many sources. Soon you see, when it's come to evil eye and the rabbinic attitude, etc., it's a lot. But I want to thank few friends and colleagues, Rabbi Shlomo Korach of Bnei Brak, Rabbi Baruch Rosenblum of Bnei Brak, Rabbi Issachar Friend of Ner Israel, and for sure other rabbonim that refuse to have the name. But while I researched this subject for today, here are some sources, so I want to give the proper kavod and the proper thank you to many friends. Parashat Balak, just as a word of intro, it's one of those parshiyot that one may wonder, how come you have a name of a person, a non-Jewish name, the first and only time in the entire five books of Moses? If you count the names, you have the portion of Noah, you have five. You have Noah, you have Yitro, Jethro, you have Balak, you have Pinchas, but again, those parshiyot that carried names, it's name of a Jewish people. Noah was Jewish, in that sense, is attributed to the Jewish people. Even you add two parshiyot, Chayei Sarah, the life of Sarah, you said it's on a person's name, and Vayichi Yaakov, you get all together seven parshiyot, but it's all a Jewish name, a Jewish people. Balak is the only non-Jewish name that we attribute to him. That's something that we will discuss. The key is this portion is like you don't see any interaction with the Jewish people, in a sense. Moses did not come out against him. It's a portion of dealing with a man, very wicked man, you can even call him evil, by the name of Balak. He was the king of Moab for a short period of time, and he hired an absolutely evil man by the name of Bilam to go ahead and curse the Jewish people. Now, the rabbis explain the motivation. Since these Jewish slaves just left the land of Egypt and they won the war against mighty nation, Sihon, for example, the Amorites, they're wondering, since they're winning war after war, and they are such as slaves that just left Egypt, what's their power? And it turns, they learn the big power is their leader, Moshe Rabbeinu, Moses, who has his tongue, his ability of speech, and he was able to, in his speech, to do a lot of things, such as the story of the Egyptian, that Moses strike him, and the rabbi said it was with the name of God, etc. So they are looking, meaning Balak, were looking for someone who is in a way equivalent to Moshe Rabbeinu. And if you look at the song Yigdal, you see that the word Lo kam bi Israel kemoshe, among the Jewish people there is no one like Moses. And the rabbis derive from that Bilam was an equivalent to Moshe Rabbeinu, which means he was in a very high level. Either you call him prophet or you call him magician, sorcerer, kosem, but still he was a very high level of clairvoyance, using his mouth and doing things that it's above other people's ability, at least appear to. So what this has to do with us? First concept we're going to zoom in is the importance of this parasha. Let me share with you a very beautiful Talmudic text, which I assume that some of you will hear it first time ever, and I know that some of you study a lot, but it's something that brightened our eyes, because it's not another text in the Talmud. Here is the word, is the Tractate Brachot, page 12. And here is the text. Amar Rabbi Abahu ben Zutarti, Amar Rabbi Yehuda bar Zvida, it's name of rabbis. Bikshu likboa parashat Balak bikriat Shma. The sages want to incorporate this week's Torah portion of Balak not only as part of our daily prayer, but they wanted to incorporate this portion as part of the most important prayer, or almost Shema in the Tefillah is the most important part of our daily prayer, this portion of Balak, either entire or part. So then they ask a question, Mipnei ma lo kva'uha? If you tell me that the rabbis gathered together and they said that the portion of Balak fully or partially should be part not only on our daily prayer but part of our Shema, so why they did not establish as part of Shema? The answer is Mishum Torah Tzibur. Simple reason, because of the burden that this will impose on a congregation to its length. People are watching all the time when we have services, when we pray, what time it's over, right? So the point is, the rabbis did not want to impose, meaning they wish to, they want to, they felt it's very important, it wasn't a controversy over that, and the only reason they didn't do it is just because they didn't want to make the service too long. So for sure the rabbis have something to inquire, and the Talmud, the Gemara, go further with that, and they said, "By Tava." Okay, we understand, but what is the real reason that they wish to establish this passage, especially some part of Balak, the whole blessing of Bil'am, as part of Shema? For those who are not 100% familiar, Bil'am was a magician. He lived far away in Midian. Balak, the king of Moab, hired him to come and curse the Jewish people. He tried very hard in many locations to do it, and he offered him a lot of money and honor. And Bil'am was so evil that willing and ready for either for money or out of tremendous hate to do it. He traveled from far and he tried hard. He wasn't successful, he opened his mouth to curse and he blessed instead. But it turns out that we, for example, the Ashkenazim, the European Jews, we have this famous statement, Ma tovu ohalecha Yaakov, how goodly are you tent of Jacob, you dwelling places of Israel, which we recite every day in the morning as part of our prayer. And this is a statement that Bil'am said with the intent to curse, it turned to be a blessing. So what's the reason we want to incorporate some part or full part of Balak with our Shema? I leima Mishum dechtiv ba el motzi'a mimitzrayim. Maybe the reason it's because Bil'am said something in that passage, it's written, God brought them out of Egypt, which means we emphasize very much the great miracle of Exodus of Egypt in Shema and other places. So they said, Leima parashat ribit u parashat mishkalot. In the Torah, there are other passages that incorporate the Exodus from Egypt. For example, the portion that dealing with charging an interest, the prohibition of taking interest, or the law of maintaining honest weights. So this should be dechtiv by Metziat Mitzrayim, for the subject of Exodus from Egypt is written in them as well. So, and those are brief passages. So what's the reason of choosing this part more than the other? And since we do not choose those parts, so why we want to take this line? Ela amar Rabbi Yossi Baravin, his name of one of the rabbis, Mishum dechtiv b'haikra kara shachav ka'ari uchlavi miyekimenu. The reason it's because the following verse it's written in the text, and they said, he crunches and lay down like a lion, and like a lion cub, who can stand him up? And this applied to the nation of Israel, which means Bilam talked about the ability of that nation, and he said they lie down like a lion and wake up like with the strength. And it's a similar to which we said every day in Shema, when you lie down, when you rise up. So the Gemara asks, Velema hai psuka vetulo? So let they say that verse and no more, which means that you don't bother the congregation, you don't impose the entire Torah portion of Balak, just add to Shema this pasuk that said he crunches and lay down like a lion, nation of Israel, and like a lion cub, who can stand him up? And that's it. So they concluded with an interesting statement. They said, Gemire kol parasha de paska Moshe Rabbeinu paskinan, de lo paska Moshe Rabbeinu lo paskinan. We have a tradition that any passage of the Torah that Moses, our teacher, divided, we divided. And any passage that is not divided, we not divided. So since the passage of Balak is I'm divided in Torah, so we not divided, recited only with its verses. Which again, it's a different subject. But the point is, it was a hava amina, it was a reflection, a thought, to incorporate either fully or partially that part. So in a way, it shows us the importance of the portion. Further on, the famous Mishnah which we study on Shabbat, this week we study the fifth chapter on the ethics of the father, thank you, the fifth chapter. So they said in the fifth chapter, Mishnah 23, Kol mi sheyesh bo shlosha dvarim alalu, hu mitalmidav shel Avraham Avinu, famous Mishnah, whoever possesses these three traits is one of the disciples of our father Abraham. Whoever possesses the three or opposite trait is one of the disciples of the trait of the wicked Bilam. Generous eye meaning good eye. A person who looks good upon other people. A modest demeanor and a humble soul are the traits of the disciples of our forefather Abraham. The opposite, an evil eye, we need to understand, we said that we're going to talk about it, an evil eye, an arrogant demander, and insatiable soul are attributes of the disciples of the wicked Bilam. Further on, if you remember early, several weeks ago, when we studied the second chapter of the Ethics of the Father, Rabbi Eliezer ben Horkinus, one of the rabbis, said that the best trait for a person is a good eye versus the worst is the evil eye, which again, it's one of the suggestions applied to the root of the souls, of a soul of a person. So here they bring a concept that you see it a lot, that it's called Ze le'umat ze asa Elokim, that God created in our language good and evil. Good, in that sense, is the attribute, is the personality of our forefather Abraham. Bad, evil, is attribute to Bilam. A side question, just food for thought. Moses lived at the time of Bilam, not Abraham. Why in the mentioning here Abraham? There are several reasons. The simple, the most traditional reason, it's because Abraham is the beginning. Abraham, it's the ability of blessings. Bilam is the ability of curse, but that's a side note. So here the big question is, since we attribute so much to this man, to Bilam, the man that was a great prophet, the highest prophet, the ability to curse, to try so hard to curse. What exactly the sources he used? What exactly the special ability he had? What power he has that it's above other people? And how it's exactly applied to our time? In the Haftarah, we are going to read Haftarah this week from the book of Micah. Thank you. In the book of Micah, the Micah, one of the late prophets, said, "Ami zchorna." He said to the nation of Israel, "My nation, remember. Remember what exactly happened to Balak, how this man hired Bilam, don't belittle these things. And how God turned around, leman dat tzidkot Hashem." The prophet Micah made a, in our language, a commandment to remember, never forget, remember, not forget. God wasn't angry, so Bilam tried, he couldn't make it, but he said, always remember what happened. In a daily prayer, we have the concept of Matovu, as we said, Ashkenazim begins the morning prayer with "How goodly are you tent, O Jacob." And Ashkenazim, right after the morning prayer, there is an additional prayer. Some people recite it daily. It's not as a public prayer, but it's as a personal additional prayer right after Shacharit, morning prayer. And it's called the Sixth Remembrance. It's a list of six important events in our history that a person should always remember. Sephardim, the Eastern brethren, the Eastern Jews, they have 10. They have 10 daily remembrance that they add after the morning service. One of them is a quotation which we just used, the quotation from the book of Deuteronomy and book of Micah, the Haftarah, that said, Micah said, Moses said, "My nation, remember what happened to Bilam, what happened to Balak. Remember, you never forget that somebody was hired to curse us, try to do us harm." Ashkenazim, as we said, we're using Matovu, "How goodly are you tent, O Jacob," and Sephardim did not mention that. So in a way, it's in balance that the Sephardim use it as one of the 10 daily zechirot. The sages tells us, if you examine very carefully every single word that Bilam used in this week's parasha, it's a length of words. "How goodly are you tent, O Jacob, you dwelling places, O Israel, you the nations that build the future and they prosper, and the divine providence among you, and if she said you lie like a lie down like a lion, etc." All these great praise, the rabbi examined it carefully, especially since they know the trait and they know the personality, and they said, "You know this Bilam, his intent was to curse. You see from the way he make those blessings, that deep in his heart, he intend to curse." It's like a person come up and wants to say something, and I assume some of you experience that. You're about to say something, you prepare something to say, and something else coming out of your mouth. Bilam wants to curse, something happened. He wants to annul, the Talmud said, Bikesh levatel batei midrashot. He wants to stop all this house of worship, and what come out, "How goodly are you tent." Bikesh shelot riyesh chiyat shchina. He asked that is no divine dwelling, and he said, "Mishkenotecha Israel," the divine dwell. And we said it in the book of Deuteronomy, and in some they said it as part of additional prayer on Saturday night, that the Almighty, "Vayafoch Hashem Elokecha Lecha את הכללה לברכה, כי אהבך השם אלוקיך. Which means, God turned the curse to a blessing. But it's important to note, the rabbi said, if you examine carefully that line, כללה is a singular, which means God turned the curse to a blessing. And the rabbi is derived from that, that some of his curses happened. Soon you see how. One, it didn't happen. The one that God turned is Matovu, that it's always house of worship. Yalkut Shimoni, which one of the Midrashic book, Rabbinic's writing, he wrote, and I quote, Ze leumat ze asa Elokim. God is always creating the two opposite, always is this type of balance between the two. Meaning, it was, for example, the men of the Great Assembly. They realized that these are tremendous idol worshippers. The Talmud relates and said that they prayed, they gathered together and they prayed that it should stop. People should stop worshipping idols, stop running after idols. And it turns that the prayer come through and it's no longer idol worshippers. But there's a price tag. It's always a price tag. And the price tag was, as a result, Pascha Nevuah, that is no longer prophecy. The rabbis tell us that since the temple destroyed, it's no longer prophecy. Further on, the Yalkut said, the rabbinic writing, the Midrash said, Hatzur Tamim Paolo, there is a line that Moses said before he passed, and he said, God is God of righteousness, God is God of truth. If the other nations will come up at the end of the days and said, come on, you didn't give us a chance. You gave the Jewish people Moses, the great teacher. That's the reason they are so great. But if you give us someone in that caliber, we will for sure worship you properly. So the response is this. Let me again read word by word. Hatsu tamim paolo. יבואו אומות העולם ויאמרו, the nation of the world come and said, לא נתת לנו כמו ישראל. God, you didn't give us an opportunity the same as you gave to the nation of Israel. The response that the Almighty said is, כשם שהעמיד מלאכים לישראל, the same way as God put a great king among the Jewish people, כך לאומות העולם. The same way God gave to other nations. And the rabbis give examples. Positive. King Solomon. King Solomon is the builder of the first Beit HaMikdash, the first holy temple in Jerusalem. Another mighty king, Nebuchadnezzar, the Babylonian king. He destroyed, which means you have two kings that dealt with tremendous power. One built temple, one destroyed temple. Second comparison, King David and Haman. Both of them, God granted wealth. Midrash. David ha'osher kana ha'bayit lishmo. When King David have tremendous wealth, he gave that money to do what? To build the Beit HaMikdash, to build the Holy Temple. Haman, he has all this tremendous wealth that the King Ahasuerus gave him in the book of Esther. And what did he do? He tried to get rid, to annihilate the entire nation toward the financial power. Another example, Moshe Rabbeinu, Moses, the great of the greatest prophets in the Bible. He talked to God all the time. Bilam, at least the way it's written, he talked to God relatively often. Look what Moses did with his prophecy, and look what Bilam did with his prophecy. So in a sense, all this claim, we didn't give you, in a sense, God said, I gave you an opportunity, and look what happened. Further on, the Talmud said in Tractate Bava Batra, it's one of the Talmudic tractate, page 15, it's a list of a prophets that was granted in general prophecy. So they bring a list of seven prophets. here are the lists. Shem, son of Noah, the three friends of Iyov, Eliphaz, and then Eliyahu ben Berachel Habuzi, Iyov, Job, Me'eretz Utz, and the seventh is Bilam ben Beor. So you have a list of seven non-Jewish prophets, and look what happened with that power. Mipnei man itnabe Bil'am. So what's the reason Bil'am received such a highest level of prophecy? The Talmud said, she'atidim umot ha'olam lomar biyom adin, that the nation of the world at the day of judgment, which we call, and many others believe in that, it will be a day which is called the day of judgment, the day that God put the whole world in the proper order. So they come and ask, Im natata lanu lavike Moshe, if you Almighty brought us a prophet in a level like Moses, hainu asukim betoratecha, we'll encourage and involve deeply in the study of Torah. Natan lahem Bil'am, God gave them the prophet Bil'am, that he uses his power, that he has the wisdom and the power in equivalent to Moses. But the result is Moses brought the people close to God. Bil'am not only did not bring them close to God, but he distanced them. Richek otam me'ashchina, he distanced them from God. Further on, now we're dealing a little bit in Kabbalah, in the mystical doctrine. In Kabbalah, and again, running out of time. I know some people love to hear Kabbalah, but it's not going to be much with this. Another time, but today just a vignette. In the Kabbalah, they're dealing with the power of Bil'am. The roots, the rabbi said, of Moses and the root of Bil'am, both roots, in a way, has the same source. Soon you see what does that mean. There is one of those books called Yalkut HaRuvani, which is a collection of different rabbinic writing, and he wrote a Kabbalistic book by the name of Emek HaMelech, which is early Kabbalah book, who said as follows. I'm reading word by word and translating my very best. Chava achla me'etz da'at. Our ancestor, the fourth mother, the first one was the Adam's wife, Eve, and she ate from the tree of knowledge. Etz Hadaat, the tree of knowledge, the Torah said, Tov Vara, they have good and they have bad. Since that event, Kol Davar Ba'olam Yesh Tov Vara, the moment that she ate it, her soul and her descendant's soul have everything that they do involved with two opposites. Always, it's something good and something bad. Example. If you take the story of her children, Cain, Abel. Cain, it's called in the Kabbalah literature, Klipa. Klipa, it's like the layer. Appear something very wicked. Abel, Kedusha, holiness, appear good. But the rabbi said, it's a combination, ta'arovet tovera, it's a combination of both. Soon you see how. Kol davar babri'a me'orav. Everything that since that event that Eve ate from the tree of knowledge, everything in creation, combining these two, Gam bara shel Kain yesh tov. Even in the bad of Cain, there is something good, and even in the good of Abel, there is something not so good. Said Yalkut HaRuveni, Tov shel Kain yatza mimeno Yitro. The descendants of Cain, you see that the king of Midian, that converted to Judaism, Jethro, Yitro, is a descendant of Cain. which means something good coming out, come out of Cain. Rachel Hevel Bilam, which means descendants of Abel, was Bilam. So again, even in ancient time there are clear epitome of good and bad, actually there is a combination of both. How come? So they said, Moshe nishmato itgalgela. He said that the spark of the soul of Moshe Rabbeinu of Moses is a, in our language, is a transmigration of souls. How come? If you take the letter of Moshe, which is Mem, Shin and Hey, the three Hebrew letters. So they said that the letter Shin, it's a spark of the soul of Shem ben Noach. So Mem is Moshe, Shin is the Shem, son of Noach, and Hey is Hevel, Abel. So the Yalkut HaRuvani said that Moshe and Bilam, they are equal because they are both, it's called in the language Yonkim Mehevel, they are descend, they are spark of the soul of Abel, which is Ta'arovet Tovera, it's a combination of good and bad. And as we said in Yigdal, that there is no other prophet among Israel like Moses, because what makes Moses so special? So they said, in a simple way, is he was disconnected from materialism. They said that the word kimin hamayim meshitihu, that when Miriam pulled him out of the river, she took him away, in our language, not just from the water, but from the materialistic world, which is the symbol, take out of the desire world. The nation, the generation of Noah, it's overwhelmed, nishtefu b'mayim, they're overwhelmed with water, which again is expression of desire. Moses, they said that he attached himself from his wife, from his family for a period of time, and he would dedicate himself to the nation of Israel and to God. Bilam, however, he has the use in the language koach ha'shchata gadol biyoter. Bilam has the ability of being self-destructive and destructive to others, the worst possible. Why? Because they say that he was hitchaber lachamor, he was connected to materialistic world, which is the she donkey, and sha'av koach tum'ah, he is basically took the power of the worst part of power of impurity. And that's the opposite of Moses, that it's the power of Kedusha. Bilam, it's impurity. Moses is the purity. What's the sort of impurity? So they said, Chochmat HaKishuv, the wisdom of all these sorcerers, magic. So the Zohar said, fascinating Zohar, on the Parshat Chayei Sarah, the portion in the book of Genesis, that, and I give just the abbreviation, they said that Bilam, he tried to contaminate himself. Chayav letamet atzmo. They use the word min aram yancheni balak meharerei kedem, that the source of all this evil sorcery, it's, they use the word Uzza ve'Azael. These are two names of you call it in our language, angels. That Bilam learned Kishuf, he learned all this ability of doing magic. And Yalkut Shimoni, again, Rabbinic's writing on Parshat Pinchas, Siman Shin Pei Hei, in one of the chapters, he said that Bilam used the full name of God, meaning he knew exactly the secret, the formula of the Holy of Holies name. As you know, God has many names. Some said 26, some said 72, but there's many names. One of them is a name that only very few people, like the high priest, like Moses knew, Bilam knew. And it's a very unbelievable midrashic writing. They said that when Pinchas went after him to kill him, which is later in the Torah portion of Matot, so Hitzliach Lachmok Ad Kisei HaKavod, Bilam used the sacred name of God, and he was able to reach a point of the highest level of chariot, which means appear before God. But in our language again, Pinchas was able to pull him back and brought him before the Sanhedrin, the court, and the court of Moses at that time kill him, as they said in a portion of Matot, that Ved Bil'am, son of Beor, argu becherb, they kill him a sword, which means it was like in our language a trial. And it concluded in the language of Midrash, Keshem she'asa Hashem nekama b'Moav u'b'Midyan, the same way as a God is a God of judgment, that he took care of the enemies at that time, which is the nation of Moab and Midian. Kach ya'aseh Hashem la'atid lavo v'ovdei kochavim. That's the way the Almighty is going to do with those who are worshipping idols. So what we see here, one of the most negative attribute to Bil'am is the attribute of evil eye. How exactly he did it? What exactly the formula involved with Bil'am here? He start with someone, it's like mazik, someone who tried to do damage. But then you see that he, in a way, at least the beginning of the parasha is like, depend on God. But then he ends up by being masitu madiach, the one who instigated and he killed. They use the word ne'uma gever shtuma ein. This is the word of a man who is either has one eye or has an evil eye, which means he was able to look, and by looking he was using a special ability in his eyes to create damage. The Talmud said in Brachot, page 7, that Bil'am knew the exact second or the exact small time, short time, that in our language God is angry, and at that specific time he cursed. Again, we're not going there, the whole example in the Talmud with the rooster, the chicken, and how exactly God, and what does that mean, angry? We're not going there. But the idea is that he was able to use his evil eye. What does that mean? We need to understand the whole concept of evil eye. Let's go further. Two sources in the Talmud. One source is in the tractate Bava Metzia. The Talmud said in Bava Metzia in two places. One, it's in page 107, Kuf Zayin. Vehesir Hashem mimcha kol choli. The promise that God will take away all the sickness from you. So it's a fascinating statement. They said that 99% of people die because of evil eye. Soon we explain what does that mean. First, let's use another source in the Talmud. The same tractate, Bava Metzia, page Pei Dalet, 84. The Talmud said as follows. Rabbi Yochanan hava azil v'yati v'share tvila. Rabbi Yochanan was, in the Talmudic text, was a beautiful face, gorgeous face, and he was sitting the place that women went for the tvila, for the mikveh. So Amru lei Rabbanan, the rabbi said to him, lo mistefe mar me'ein abisha. Everybody look at your face, you appear everywhere and everyone see your face. Don't you afraid of the evil eye? So the rabbis tells us in several books, for example, Chazon Ish, the great rabbi, said in the Choshen Mishpat, and others, they said that when a person, in a way, ostentatiously, in a very showing off way, show something that he has more than the others, can be wealth, can be other things like talents, he brings the eye of other people, which create a looking that come out of jealousy, that may create a damage to a person. Maharal, the great 16th century rabbi in Czechoslovakia, he said, he wrote extensively Kabbalah literature, and he said that one of the special ability that God gave at the time of creation, it's the idea that people being jealous of each other, which is supposed to create good in some ways. For example, kinat sufrim tarbe chokhma, if there is a jealousy among the people who are scribes or sages, it can bring more wisdom, but it can be a very destructive. Jealousy can create a terrible thing. Amar lehu, Rabbi Yochanan responded, he said, ענה מזרעה דיוסף כעתינה, דלא שלטה בעינה בישה. I am a descendant of famous biblical Joseph, that is no evil eye upon him. And that's, by the way, a statement the rabbi said a person should say if he's, he or she is afraid of evil eye. So what does that mean, that Joseph is the evil eye cannot control him? Dechtiv, because it's written when Jacob gave his blessing before his past to Joseph, in Genesis 49 he said, Ben Porat Yosef, Ben Porat Ale Hain, which means that they use the word Porat. What is Porat? So they use the word Porat to say that in that Priah, that it's like God paid him. What exactly paid him? So there's a very famous statement. They said that Joseph was basically was the one who protected in several incidences. One, שלא נתן בעיניו בשינו שלו, which means when he has the incidents of the wife of Potiphar, the married woman that tried to seduce him, he didn't look at his eyes over some property that belonged to someone else, which is married woman, and God rewarded him that no one evil eye can control him. He was the viceroy king, almost the most powerful man in that generation of the world, or you may say the most powerful person in his generation. Another incident, they said that when Jacob introduced to his brother Esau all his wealth, all his family, Joseph stood before his mother Rachel, Amad lifnei Rachel, he stood before his mother and he said, I want to hide you, mom. I knew that you, mom, Rachel, are beautiful, and I don't want this wicked Esau to think about you or to take you. So I want to protect you. I'm standing at the front of you so he will not see you, will not control any evil eye on you. And in a sense, God rewarded him that no one controlled him in the evil eye. That's one source. But as another fascinating source, in the page 107, the Talmud said that the Amar Rabbi Abahu Amar Rav Huna Amar Rav, statement from the rabbis, אסור לו לאדם, a person is forbidden, שיעמוד על שדה חברו בשעה שתבועה עומדת בקמותיה. Which means, you're standing next to your even friend when he's flourishing, when you see his field grow. Why? Because it creates jealousy and creates some type of evil eye. The Rambam tells in Hilchot Shechenim that it's a question if it's halacha or midat chasidut, if that's the really considering some liability, something that you can go after the person for doing that or not. But in general, it's not something that you're taking a gun or knife and damage. You're just looking and sometimes wishing bad to someone. But you may say, what do I wish bad? I'm just looking what he has. It's not so simple, because soon you see a source, again, it's frightening source, that proof how serious the rabbis take the whole concept of Ayin Hara. Here are some. The Talmud said in Tractate Psachim, page 50, they said, המסתכל בקנקנים אינו רואה ברכה לעולם. Imagine you have a friend, he has a very big field, and he's selling big vase or big something that you see it. He has a few acres and it's filled of products. Can be, let's say, $5,000 or $10,000 value of property. So everybody looked and said, look at him, look how rich is he. He has all these beautiful different product, different vases. Versus you see a fellow who carry jewelry or diamond, can be a small package in his pocket. Nobody knows he's hiding a value of, let's say, $100,000. That's worth four times more than the other fellow who have few acres of property. Why? Because this one, the jewelry, the diamonds, is hiding in a pocket, and this one is ostentatious. Everybody can see it, and it creates jealousy. In the book Tuv Chai Abihu, one of the great Israeli rabbi wrote a story about Rabbi Isser Meltzer. Rabbi Isser Meltzer was one of the giant in the past generation. He lived in Jerusalem, and he used to walk from his house of study, from yeshiva to his house, toward the Shuk, Machne Yehuda. Those who visit Israel know that place. So he used to circumvent that area. He didn't go straight to that Shuk, and he said, when he goes there and he see all the fresh product, and you see all the beauty of all this farming, like you see here in our city, the Amish market, sometimes they put outside all the fresh farm product. You see gorgeous big tomatoes, and it's like triple than the other stores, and fresh and beautiful. It creates some type of, in his view, ayin hara. Further, the Talmud said, if a person matzah shatiach, if a person walked and he found a beautiful carpet or a beautiful something that's very nice, don't put it publicly. Be careful, because en abisha, because there is some type of jealousy. The Talmud said another source in Tractate Bava Batra, Kuf Mem Aleph 141, they said, Batchila siman yafeh labanim. If a person has a first child, a daughter, it's a good sign for sons. What does that mean? So for certain adult, for certain groups, daughter, it's like, we all believe that they are equal or sometimes even more important, because the first daughter can be very helpful for the rest of the children. But it means, in the eye of the rabbis, it's avoiding an evil eye. Is another source, the Talmud said in Tractate Kiddushin about Tagra. In those days, when people were not well, they used to have a person who pull out blood from people in order to heal them. So the Talmud said that that person was usually a unpleasant individual, and Rashi elaborated, and he said that he was even evil, because Eino ra'a bebri'im, when he sees someone who's well and healthy, he used to say, oh, I wish that he is not so well, so he can come and I can pull out some blood of him. So it shows you again that there's a tendency of people to say things, and even it sounds good, they meant something else. Now is a fascinating text in the Talmud that really, in a way, even scary, but that's the word of the rabbis. I'm just sharing with you what the rabbis said. Is a Talmud, Tractate Sanhedrin, page 92. The Talmud said, Tanu Rabbanan, Shisha Nisim Na'asu Ba'oto Hayom. The Talmud relate a story about three great people in the Tanakh, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, there are three people that ready and willing, even the prophet warned them, to go to the fire and die for Kiddush Hashem, for the sanctification of name of God. So the Talmud said that they went there, they went to the fire, and miraculously they saved. No one believed how these people were saved. They went to the fire, they went to the, and the Nebuchadnezzar, the evil Babylonian king, put them in the fire, and lo and behold, they stay in the fire, and nothing happened to them. They walk out, and they are fine. And the Talmud said that, it's a quotation from the book of Daniel, that he called them Bnei Elaka, sons of God, which again, we need to understand what does that mean, but basically it showed that they are like really great righteous people, that they are saved even from being thrown to the fire. But then the rabbis ask, so what happened to them? Since these three great people went to the fire and they are saved, so why we don't read anything further about them? And the rabbis tells us something that it's still, if you read this, it's really, I believe, have an effect on everyone. They say that people were talking, and everyone said, look at this, three people. They went to the fire, even the prophets warned them, and they went there and nothing happened to them. And because of that evil eye, they died. Frightening. The rabbis go further to say, and that's again, that source in the Talmud, Bava Metzia Kuf Zayin 107, They say that one of the rabbis has, again, special ability. We are limited with our understanding. But he went to the cemetery, and he was able to track down to know the cause of death. So you said this one died from... I understand your question. So the thing is, what they try to say in this Gemara, that the six special miracles that happened to Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, it's a great miracle, it's a wonderful thing. I mean, six miracles that happened, and the miracle in Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. But the rabbi wants to emphasize the effect that the evil eye has, that these people were saved from fire. So it goes to show you, soon I'll show you some sources, that even a great people and a great miracle, when it's an evil eye can take away even the power of miracle, which is mind-boggling. The Talmud said, go further, because I know you have a question, just let's continue. The Talmud said in Bava Metzia, Pei Dalet Amud Bet, 84b, so, abbreviation, there's a story of a great Rebbe. In those days, it was some people were sitting on the floor, or almost like machzelet, and some more advanced, they're sitting on like safsal and a bench. And Rebbe and another rabbi, Hanan ben Gamliel, they are sitting like everybody else, and some people are concerned because they are giant scholars. So they went to a special store and ordered, in our language, like fancy chair for them. Fine. So they get those chairs, and the Talmud said that they bought those chairs and they sat on them, and the father of Rebbe came and he said, "You crazy. I have only one son, and you want to take away this son with the evil eye that he's now have a fancy chair? No. Take it away and let him sit like everybody else." So the rabbi said, okay, what about the other who has no parents? Says, let him sit like everybody else. This is an evil eye. You should not do that. Let me share with you Shulchan Aruch and Or HaChaim. I have here also the Kitzur Shulchan Aruch, the abbreviation. Here is just the abbreviation. Rabbi Ganzfried tells us in chapter 23, Siman Kav Gimel, 13. As en korim shne achim ze achar ze, ben shem min ha'av, ben shem min ha'em. When you call up the Torah reading, so you call up, you do not call up two brothers to go to be Ole, to get Aliyah of the Torah, one after the other, regardless whether they are, you know, brothers from the parental or maternal brothers. Why? The same idea, evil eye. V'chen ha'av im bno ben bno. Similarly, the father with his son and grandson, we do not call for Aliyah to be Ole, one after the other, mishumena bisha, because of the evil eye, to avoid attracting the injurious attention of an evil eye, ayin hara, we refrain from calling upon these relatives one after the other, consequently. And you think about it, v'afilu hem omrim she'enam makpidim, he continues and says, this will be avoided, even they'll say, we don't care for that, we don't care for this evil eye. V'afilu ha'echad u'acharon v'asheni maftir. Even you have the seven aliyot on Shabbat, and you have additional acharon aliyah, and then you have a maftir, which is basically, maftir is not part of the regular count of olim. You say the kaddish, it's separated, so you think that it's, he says, no, you can't do that because it's the evil eye. And this is already the code. You speak about father, son, or grandson, two brothers can create unnecessary jealousy. Rabbeinu Bahya ibn Pakuda was a great Sephardi rabbi who was also a judge in Spain, lived at the 10th century. He wrote extensively the duty of the hearts and the commentary on the Torah. On the Torah portion of Vayetzeh, he speaks about something, again, mind-boggling. Ma'aseh nisim, something that is really miracle. And he brought how even a great miracle that's supposed to take place can be annulled by evil eye. So we all know the story from the book of Kings. The story was the prophet Elijah, and he has his attendants, whose name is Gehazi. And it was a woman that helped them. She set up a room for the great man of God, for Elisha, and she set all the needs for him, and he wants to bless her. It's called the place Shunem. And he asked her, I just use our language, so he asked her, what can I do for you? She says, nothing, I don't want anything. He says, I insisted, no. He says, write me something you need. No. So Gehazi, Elisha's attendants, he said, you know, this woman has no children. She's a barren woman. So Elisha right away said, next year you'll have a son. And she says, Al tashle oti. Why are you saying all of this? I don't do it for these things. He says, no, I insisted. You have next year a son. Fine. So the text tells us, it's a well-known story. She have a son, and he grew up, and he went to the field, and while he helped him in the field, he passed. And she took that child, that baby, and she brought him to Elisha. She took that child, and she went to Elisha. She left him, and she went to Elisha, and she asked him for help. So Elisha gave his staff to Gehazi, his attendants, and he says, go right away over there. If anybody will talk to you, don't talk to them. Don't engage with any conversation with anybody. Just go and use this staff, and I bless that it will be a miracle. Some said it was the same staff that used for Moses to perform this miracle in Egypt. Anyway, it was a staff that he gave. And the text tells us how Gehazi went, and he went further, and it's a two version what exactly happened and how it happened. One is the version of the Midrash Tanhuma, who said that he stopped by, and Elisha warned him not to talk to anybody, but he talked to people. And one version said that they asked him, where are you going? He says, on a mission. What type of mission? They said, Elisha sent me. What did he send you? To use this staff to revivify a child, and like showing off. And that basically create an evil eye and take away that ability. Or according to Rabbeinu David Kimchi Radak, he says, I want to check this, if it really works. And according to the text, what they do, it was a dog. And the dog was dead, and he took the staff and he tried it. And again, it's hard for us to understand, but he revivified, the staff revivified the life of the dog. In other words, he used that ability, which was only once, for the dog. But the point is, Rabbeinu Bachya tried to say that the koach hanes mitbatel al yedei ayin hara, which means when it's the evil eye, even is the power of miracle, it can be annulled, even annulled, by an evil eye. It was a miracle supposed to be in the staff. Gehazi was asked to do it, and he didn't do it because of that. He brought in Parashat Vayetz in particular, because over there is a story about Jacob and Laban, and Jacob has all these flocks, and Torah used the word akudim, nekudim, uvrudim. He has a different flock, different livestock. And he knew that the in-law, Laban, was a wicked person, have all this trait of Bilam, and he could create a evil eye. So he did all kind of things to make sure that it's not going to control the flock, the prosperity of the flock. Another source he brought, it's the story of Leah, the wife of Jacob. She was a prophetess, and she knew that Jacob is going to have 12 children. But the Torah said that when she, in that sense, each wife, there's the two wives, Leah and Rachel, and the two midwives, Bilhah and Zilpah. So, in a way, Leah expecting three kids. When she have Reuben, Shimon, and Levi, then she have an extra in that sense, she have the fourth child. So she called him Yehuda, Judah, and she said, "Ata hapam odeh et Hashem." He says, "Now I want to say an extra thank you to God." So what does that mean? Extra thank you to God. So, in a way, it's hard for us again to fully comprehend. But let's try together. What he tried, Rabbeinu Bachya tried to say, that she created an evil eye by herself to herself. Which means, she said, look at me, look how God blessed me. I'm expecting three sons, and all of a sudden, I have the fourth one. And the Torah said, "Vata'amod miledet." after the son, the fourth son, stop. Which means, in a sense, a person, the rabbis derive from that, can create an evil eye by himself to himself. A success and blessing that's supposed to bestow upon him, he can annul it by himself for creating an evil eye with himself by himself. Deep concept. Further on is a book called Akedah by a great sage, Rabbi Yitzchak Arama. He quotes something again, mind-boggling but fascinating. The Talmud said in Tractate Zvachim, Kuv Bet Amud Aleph, 102b, Tractate Zvachim. They said about Elisheva. Elisheva was the Aaron's wife. Aaron's, the biblical Aaron, has a wife by the name of Elisheva. And we all know the story, how you see it in Leviticus 10 and others, that she lost the two sons, Nadav and Avihu. So they said, what exactly happened and how that happened? So one of the interpretations, the Baal HaKedah, Rabbi Yitzchak Arama said, he said, Chamesh smachot haita Elisheva yetera al Israel. She, in a five different attributes, she was advanced and she created evil eye to herself by herself. Either saying to others or to herself. What does that mean? This is what she said. She saw a great celebration when God forgave Mechilat Chet HaEgel, when God forgave for the mistake of the golden calf, the sin of the golden calf. So she said, look how lucky I am. Look how lucky am I. One, I am the wife of the high priest. I am the wife of Aharon. One. Two, Gisi Melech. My brother-in-law is a king, which is Moses, is considering like a king, the head. Shnei Banai, my two sons, Sganei Kohanim, the second in command for the priest, which is Nadav and Avihu, her two sons. Nechdi Pinchas, Mashuach Milchama, my grandson is a great biblical Pinchas, which was the anointed person. And then, Achi, Rosh Shevet, Nachshon Ben Aminadab. My brother is the head of the tribe of Judah, Nachshon Ben Aminadab. So she said, how lucky am I to have this from everywhere. I'm so blessed. I have my husband, the high priest. My brother-in-law is the king. My two sons are second in command. My grandson is Pinchas. My brother is the head of the tribe. He says, Natna ayin hara be'atzma. She created an evil eye for herself, and that time, right away, Vayamutu Nadav Avihu. She lost two sons, Nadav and Avihu. And he concluded and he says, Zeu koach ayin hara. This is the power of the evil eye that goes so far that even a person like Elisheva, who create ayin hara by herself to herself. Either she did it for herself, or she said it and others give it to her. Midrash Tanchuma, Parshat Kitisa, said as follows. Lama nishtabru luchot rishonot? What's the reason that the first tablets was broken? He answered and he says, nitnu bepumbi, because it was given in public. So in other words, it's given in public, it's create some type of enviness or jealousy, and it was broken. Amar Hashem, the Almighty said, En lecha midah yafa min hatzniut, is nothing better than to have modesty. And again, Sefer HaKedah, Rabbi Yitzchak Arama said, when God called upon Moses, and he said to him at that time, Ve'ish lo yale imach, you come up to Mount Sinai to be with me. God said, you should come alone, nobody else will join you. Shelo yiru shata mekabel haTorah, that no one else will see that you receive the Torah. So here Bilam, what is the evil eye? Bilam received the ability that he knew how goodly all you tend to Jacob, what he meant to say. So the Midrash said, Empt pitchem mechuvanim. The Talmud, the Gemara said, and we studied it not long ago in Tamid 32, Lamed Bet. The Gemara said in Tamid, what exactly happened? Ma ya'avid inish ve'yichyeh. The Talmud says, oh, we describe so many incidences that evil eye can be destructive. So in which way a person can survive? So they said, here is the advice from Bilam. How a person can survive? They said, yamit et atzmo. A person should kill himself. So they said, what does that mean, kill himself? Amar ha-mefaresh, the commentator, right there in Tamil, like Rashi, but it's somebody that's called ha-mefaresh, it's unknown. He says, adam she-rotze lichyot, if a person wants to live longer, yashpil et atzmo, yirachamu alav, v'yichne shanim rabot. A person should hide himself under the table, hide himself, hide his, whatever he has, his wealth. So people have compassion on him, and he live longer, and v'chen lehefer, and also the other way. And go further, the Talmud in Sanhedrin 14 said, the proper peaceful life, he said, hevet sanua venistar, a person will hide himself from the evil eye, from others, jealousy, so they said, the Tosfot tells us in the Tractate Shabbat, the famous Tosfot, he says that it was a cloud, when they are in a desert, the cloud on Israel, then they can see everything, can see what's happening. However, the key here is, Bilam said, how goodly are you tent, which means, I don't focus my life to know exactly what happened in my fellow's life. Meaning, I don't involve with all these gossips, gossip newspapers, gossip internet, gossip information, gossip chat room, gossip Facebook, Twitter, and all these things that involve in gossip. So for example, if you win a lottery, or you get the inheritance, or whatever it is, okay, make sure that it's out of the big public eye. That's the advice. And again, the whole idea of Bilam, he saw that people are not looking at each other. You see a person who said, like Bilam, he said, how goodly are you ten? It's like he's saying, oh, look at this person, he has this BMW or beautiful home or beautiful husband or wife or whatever it is. And even you praising that person, deep in your heart, you express tremendous jealousy. And that's the reality. Sometimes it's come via negativa, but many times it's like Bilam. So that's what exactly the Mishnah said in Ethics of the Father, chapter 5. They said, someone who's basically intent deep in his or her heart, not the good, but just said as a good things, it's a problem. This month, the rabbi said that the month of Tammuz, it's a month of the ice. It's a lot of ice. It's in the rabbinic literature described as a month that, in a sense, be careful with the ice. My late father-in-law, who's died from that cancer disease, very young, he got that at the age of 50 and he died that year. He used to say that, you know, how is the source of that cancer disease? It starts with the small cells in the body and it spread. And they used, when people came to comfort the family, the comfort after the loss, you know, he left grieving wife and 11 children. The man was only 50 years old, chief rabbi of Shomron and the great giant Torah scholar. One of the rabbanim said, Tov ayin hu yevorach. He said something that struck me, but still had the impression. He says, you know what happened? It was a great jealousy. He was athletic, he was young, he looks young, he was beautiful, he was a beautiful family and have 11 children and have all this establishment of so many shuls and eruv and mikveos all over the Shomron and it's recognized by everybody. So it creates something. Is that true? That's the reason. Who am I? But if you look at the Talmud that we refer earlier about this great rabbi that went to the cemetery and he said a statement, he said, people can die from different things, but he says, I have the ability to find the source of the sources. And he said, 99 out of 100, the original reason that all these crises befall upon them, it's evil eye. So now you see why it's so much involved with rabbinic's writing about evil eye, why this Torah portion involved with Bilam, an expression of what evil eye potentially can do, and want to teach us an important lesson, the whole idea of not only be satisfied, but also a person should be careful. And there's several advisors mentioned, the idea of being humble, the idea of hiding that, not even praising yourself, be careful what you said and be careful what other people said, and even when they praising or even you praise, be careful when you said and how you said it. You know the phrase in Yiddish, "Kenayin Hora," without an evil eye. That's applied to that as well. So I see here there's several questions, but we're going to discuss it later on. Show me where.